Good morning, this is Faith of Faith and Books, and I'm going to do a short video today. This is the second installment this week. Yeah, is this my second altogether? Anyway, I'm not going to go off on little tangents like that because I notice I speak like that and it makes the video longer than it needs to be. Anyway, I'm doing my McClure’s magazine, May is for Magazine, which is a challenge to read articles from magazines that were published before you were born. And I happen to have a collection of McClure’s magazine. And this one, that I'm going to look at three different ones really quickly and spend the most time on the last one. So I'm trying to go chronologically through my magazines. The next issue that I have is October 1893. You see that? And this one has a little bit of a different cover. The other ones all have like these mini table of contents, and then with a more detailed table of contents inside. This one is a little bit different. And it didn't have any women journalists. I'm focusing on women journalists of the time. One thing though that was of interest is they have a certain feature called human documents. Can you see that? And that is photography. It's photos of well-known people through the ages. And one of the people that they feature is a woman named Frances Elizabeth Willard, who was born in 1839. She became the dean of a woman's college. Northwestern University? Where is that? She became dean, but anyway, she became involved in the Woman's Christian Temperance Union, and she was one of the founders of the Prohibition Party. So this is a photo kind of essay of her. You can see her there, and then, so there, at her different ages. So I find the first one absolutely terrifying. Doesn't that look spooky? Ooh. So that's when she's a young girl. Then the next one is when she's age 20. That one. And then here, she looks almost exactly the same at 37. And then there she is at the present age, however old she was in October 1893. So that's my cat. Can you hear my cat? It's okay. What's the matter? What's the matter? Anyway, hopefully he'll stop. He wants to go inside. Hold on a second. Hold on. Let's see. Okay, he brought in a mouse. He's telling me he brought a mouse or a vole or something. All right, so, I mean, that's good for the garden because those critters like to eat the garden, but I don't like having to deal with corpses. Anyway, okay, so enough of that interruption. So that was I thought that photo essay was interesting, and that this woman, dean of a woman's college, had been so involved, say, in the Prohibition Party, which we know how well that worked out. Let's see. And then the next one, this one is April 1894. This is somebody wrote on this one. What was his name? J.A. Gay? It looks like G.A.Y. You see that? This one, I started to read an article about Ellen Terry, the famous stage actress at this time. And it was written by an Ethel Mackenzie McKenna. Can you get any more Scottish than that? And I looked her up and I couldn't find any information on Ethel Mackenzie McKenna. And I noticed she also wrote other articles for McClure’s. And I started to read this one on Ellen Terry. And it was kind of a puff piece. It didn't hold my interest very much. You can look at some of the pictures. There's a picture of Ellen Terry's parlor there. They have really nice pencil sketches. Here's another one of her lying on her couch, because apparently, even though she lived to her 80s and was an active actress, you know, like so many women of that time, well, I complain about things too. She was always complaining of poor health. There she is again, a great actress. Oh my gosh. I think that mouse is still alive. Oh my, the cat is cruelly playing with it. Oh my gosh. Anyway, here's some more sketches. Those are animals being animals. I'm reading Tarka the Otter, and one thing about it is there's no, you know, sugarcoating life in the wild where, you know, it's a predator and prey. Anyway, back to McClure's. So then I decided the person I really wanted to learn about was Ida Tarbell, who I talked about in my last installment. And so in 1890, I have a compilation of some of the volumes of McClure's from 1896. And she wrote a biography of Lincoln. So apparently she wrote it in response to a well-known book that had just come out about Lincoln. She didn't like the tack that it took. Because it was very much just about his political career and just lots of facts about that. And she wanted to humanize Lincoln. And so what I like about Ida Tarbell is she did her own research. She went and she interviewed all these different people who knew Lincoln, his neighbors, his business associates, people who went to church with him. Discovered or she published for the first time all these letters he had written to various people. So she'd spent a long time researching, and then she wrote this book, and it came out in serial form in McClure's, which I think by this time she had become an editor. She'd moved back from Paris, and she was now working for McClure's. So this has a picture of Mark Twain there, but it's really about Lincoln here. That just happens to be the last photo from the previous article. So here is a chapter from her, The Life of Abraham Lincoln. It says, the beginning of the chapter, it's conclusion of Lincoln's term in Congress, fidelity to friends causes Lincoln to lose the general land office, refuses the governorship of Oregon. I had no idea he was offered that. Decides to give his whole attention to law, Lincoln's life in Springfield, adopts a plan of self-culture. So I'll just read the first and last paragraphs, and then I'll just show you the photos. It's really well written. I can see why Ida Tarbell had a good reputation. The first paragraph, it says, the first impression of slavery which Abraham Lincoln received was in his childhood days in Kentucky. So great an evil did his father and mother hold it that to escape it, they were willing to leave their Kentucky home and move to a free state. Thus, their boy's first notion of the institution was that it was something to flee from. And there we have a picture of the first Presbyterian church that Lincoln attended in Springfield. Here's a portrait of him. And let's see, who is this guy? This is a friend, Gillespie. Judge Joseph Gillespie, who was his friend, and he wrote many letters too, and his daughter, I think, gave a lot of letters to Ida Tarbell. And this is Zachary Taylor. And this guy here is, this is Justin Butterfield. This is a general. There was some sort of thing when Lincoln came back from his term in Congress, back to Illinois. I think he had been the general land office. I think he had run that before. I'm not sure, because this is a chapter in the middle of the book, and I don't really know the details of Lincoln's life, especially before he was president. But anyway, when he came back, he wanted his friend to get the job for general land office, which seemed to be a very prestigious job. And this guy came in and finagled his way in, and it caused acrimony between Lincoln and the guy that he had wanted to get the job. So that's him. I don't know anything more about him, just quoting what I read in the article. Then here we have some furniture that was in Lincoln's home. This sofa was actually built for Lincoln because he was so tall. they had it built for him. This is his house. He had one of the nicest houses in Springfield. And Link, you can't see it here. There's two people standing here, but in the yard, you can see Lincoln standing with one of his sons. That's the article. And then, a chapter in the book. My cat is walking around. then the last paragraph is, so it went on to talk about various things, and the last thing was self-culture. So coming back, I guess, from Washington, Lincoln realized that he was not as educated as other people. And so he decided to self-educate, and he went at, during this time in Springfield, he studied geometry and astronomy. There's my cat back there. Oop, wait, until you turn. There you go. Another really interesting thing was, so apparently, I'm not sure if he had two terms, did he have two terms or one term that was broken up? Because at one point, after he'd gotten to Washington, D.C. and was working as a congressman, he went to, was he a congressman? He took a trip up to New England and he met abolitionists up there, and that kind of rekindled his own anti-slavery beliefs. So when he came back, he did two things. Well, he'd done one thing all along. There was something called the Wilmot Proviso, which was, and he apparently voted it for over 40 times or something, that they kept trying to get passed that would say all new territories would be free states, and that never passed. And then he, when he came back from this trip to New England, he tried to get slavery outlawed in the District of Columbia, and you could actually see a slave market from the Capitol, and that didn't get passed either. And then he came home to Illinois, and this is the period when he's at home and he's reestablishing his law office. And during this time, he tried to teach himself geometry, astronomy, other things too. He even tried to learn German, and he actually formed a German club, and people would come and study at his office. But this is the last paragraph of the of this particular installment in the book about Lincoln. It was to make up for the chance at an education which he did not have in youth that Abraham Lincoln, at 40 years of age, after having earned the reputation of being one of the ablest politicians in Illinois, spent his leisure. So that's very, very interesting. And I think I'm just going to maybe pursue Ida Tarbell, because, you know, if I'm only doing this twice a week in the month of May, I don't actually have that many opportunities to focus on her. So I think I might just dedicate the rest of May to Ida Tarbell, because I find her fascinating. Okay, I was hoping to make this a little bit shorter, so I'm going to end now. Have a great day, and I'll talk to you later. Bye.